أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل على محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. اللهم أرنا الطلعة الرشيدة والغرة الحميدة وكحول ناظري بنظرة مني إلي، وعجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه وأوسع منهجه واسلك بي مهجته. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wa a'zam Allah ujurana wa ujurakum bi musabina bil Husayn wa awlad al Husayn wa ashab al Husayn. The day of Friday in the Islamic calendar is a holy day, the day of Jumu'ah, that we have the Friday prayer on this day. It's a holy day in the Islamic calendar in every week, and as I've mentioned to you before, the holidays in Islam are holidays. Friday, therefore, well, it's a holiday in the Islamic calendar, and also it's a holiday. According to the riwayat, different days depend like they are dedicated to different imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam to remember them, and Friday or Saturday or from tonight Friday evening is dedicated to Imam al-Hujjah ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. Usually this is my commitment, that everywhere I go to talk, I make sure that at least one session I dedicated to speaking about Imam al-Hujjah ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. And you appreciate that he is the actual host of these gatherings that we have anywhere in the world during his time, because he is our present Imam. Because he is our present Imam and the only living member of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, anywhere in the world, any majlis is held in memory of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, he is the host. As the Imam, as the living pure progeny of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. It is so important for us to always make sure that we increase our knowledge about Imam Zaman ajjalallahu farajahu sharif, and never be content with what you know about the Imam. Okay? Remember always this hadith that Shia and Sunni have narrated it, that man mata wa lam ya'rif Imam Zamaneh mata mitatan jahiliyyah. If we die without knowing the Imam of our time, our death is considered the death of Jahiliyyah. The death of Jahiliyyah, the death of ignorance, is an expression for someone who as if has not died a Muslim. All right? So to make sure that I die Muslim and a good Muslim, good mu'min, I need to know the Imam of my time. Now, knowing the Imam, of course, has degrees. Iqra waraqa. Always there is room to improve our knowledge about our present Imam. The very bare minimum of it that children start is that Imam Zaman, his father was Imam Hassan Askari alayhi salam, his mother Narjis Khatun, and things like that, biological information. One issue, inshallah, tonight I want to share with you about knowing the Imam of our time is to answer a question and kind of a misconception about our Imam. And then you'll appreciate that how delicate the issue of knowing the Imam is. That with all respect to them, some of our very eminent scholars, we say that based on the opinion of the majority of our scholars, those scholars, although they're quite famous scholars, and no need to mention their names, with all respect to them, they had slipped and they have made a mistake in understanding this issue about Imam Mahdi Ajalallah Farajahu Sharif. The question and the misconception following that is the following, that what is Imam Mahdi doing? Have you ever thought? We all believe that our present Imam has been living over a millennium, more than 1,000 years, almost 1,200 years has passed since the beginning of his occultation. What has he been doing all these years? If somebody asks you that, why do you need an Imam that you don't see? You can't go to him. What is he doing? Doesn't he get bored? The misconception here is that some, and I told you that among them are some eminent scholars, that if I mention the names, you will be surprised. They say that our Imam is in occultation and in hiding. Sometimes they say that he is living in an island known as Al-Jaziratul Khadra, the Green Island. Sometimes they say that he lives in a very mysterious island known as the Bermuda Triangle. You must have watched the movies and the plane passing over it and what happens. And they said these are the hosts and the army of Imam Zaman shooting them. And no plane can fly over that island that is apparently in the Atlantic Ocean, that even NASA cannot detect them. Or some historically they say Imam Mahdi had disappeared in a basement in Samarra, Sardab in Samarra, and still he is somehow somewhere there in occultation secretly. So what is he doing this? They said to protect himself. What we want to talk about, inshallah, tonight is to clarify this misconception and see what pure Islamic evidence provide to have a better understanding about our present Imam Ajalallah Farajahu Sharif. Yes, notwithstanding that they say that yes, he is in hiding, but sometimes randomly that he knows best, like during the Hajj season, if you are lost in Arafat, in Mina, and you lost your group, he may come and take you back to your group as it has been reported. Now and then something. But no, he doesn't have any duty. And if you go to him, if you could go to him, say that, Ya Ibn Rasulallah, look at what is happening in the world with all the crises, what is happening in Lebanon, in Palestine, in Syria, in Iraq, Afghanistan. Look at what is going on to the Shia, how much they are oppressed. Why you are not doing anything? The Imam, as if the Imam says that, look, you know what? At the moment, my office is closed. I don't have any duty. Until God calls me, until God decides, then I appear and then I take care of everything. But at the moment, I'm in isolation, just dedicating myself to the worshipping of God. Like as if Imam Zaman Ajalallah Farajahu Sharif, they think that Imam Mahdi is somewhere in secretly just praying, fasting, reading Quran, and like a hermit. Like a hermit in a cave, just being busy with his worshipping. If really we say this about our Imam, and this is our belief, definitely this is a wrong understanding of the Imam. And I'm afraid that hadith of man mata wa lam ya'rif Imam Zamane somehow applies to us. Scholarly, if some scholars, as they apparently it seems that's what they had suggested, if they have gone to that conclusion, it's like what you call it, they say that this is an expert mistake. But alhamdulillah, the mainstream and the majority of our scholars, they don't hold this opinion. And I always tell you that on issues of different opinions, it's always safer to stick to the middle of the road, stay with the mainstream. Don't go to the odd opinions if you want to be safe. On that issue of Al-Jazirat Al-Khadra, that Allama Majlisi mentions a very long story in Bihar Al-Anwar, and it seems that he is very much inclining towards that, unfortunately. My teacher, Ayatollah Hassan Zadeh Hafizahullah, was quoting from his very eminent teacher, Ayatollah Rafi'i Ghazwini Rahmatullah Alayhi, that he had done a thorough research on the topic, and he said that, you know, the true story has been this. Al-Jaziratul Khadra, the Green Island, was an expression centuries back for Andalus, today's Spain, because it's a green area, and was conquered by the Muslims. One of the Bani Abbas kings, whose name was, or whose title is Al-Mahdi, the Abbasi king, he took his capital, moved his capital to that Green Island in Spain, that used to be part of the Islamic territory, and you know the story of the massacre in Spain anyway, of Muslim massacres. Because his name was Al-Mahdi, and he resided there with his host, with his army and things like that, some naive people, they thought that the Mahdi, the savior, Imam Mahdi, Ajalla Farajul Sharif, that his name is mentioned. And I've come across individuals that they read Tariq al-Ya'qubi, the history book, and talks about Al-Mahdi, and they thought that they're reading about Imam Mahdi. And they assume that Imam Mahdi has been residing there, in that island. You know today that really, if that was the case, that Imam Mahdi was living in Spain, you could drive there. Okay? If Imam Mahdi and his soldiers, his companions, would live in an island in Atlantic Ocean, impossible to say that NASA could not spot them up and know exactly what are they doing, where are they living, and or things like that. Even when you read the story that Allama Majlisi mentions, you can find so many flaws and mistakes in it, really. And I don't have time to go to the details of it. Anyway, what we say in response to that is that we believe our Imam, our present Imam, not only his office is not suspended, and he is not retired, or he is not like not working. On the contrary, as inshallah, as much as my time allows me tonight to share this fact with you, you will appreciate that Imam Mahdi Ajallallahu Farajul Sharif, he is not only active, he is a mujahid. He has been a mujahid since the beginning of occultation until the time that he will appear. And I have different reasons to share with you for that, with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Two, three different approaches to answer that misconception. The first is a rational approach. My rational approach to this argument is the following. Imam Mahdi Ajjalallah Farajul Sharif, yes, by the leave and the permission of God, by the will of God, he is in occultation. Yani, people cannot recognize him, as we'll see. They may see him. You might have sometimes in your life have come across Imam Mahdi seeing him, but you do not recognize him. Someone like this that cannot be recognized, cannot be identified, in fact, he will be safer if he lives in the public. Because he will not be recognized, no one will be able to harm him. Because yes, if they know he's Imam Mahdi, they may kill him, they may harm him. But now that they don't know who he is, he will be in a safer position. And as such, it's easier for him to walk around, to manage the affairs of the community globally. This is one. So his occultation is something to his advantage, not disadvantage. Number two, principles that we have in Islam, one of them is the principle of enjoining good and forbidding evil. Al-amr bil-ma'roof wa nahya anil munkar. Now, is it possible to say that over a millennium, for such a long time, Imam Mahdi, and he's an imam, he's living, but he's not concerned and he's not practicing this obligation of al-amr bil-ma'ruf wa nahi anil munkar? Islam is not just praying and fasting. Amr bil-ma'ruf is as obligatory as much as salat and fasting it is. So is it possible for Imam Mahdi to see all this corruption on earth? all this oppression and doesn't do anything. This is against the Islamic principle. Definitely, this is not the imam that, he won't be the imam, he won't be the leader. This is two. The third, this is the first, the rational approach. The second approach is when you look at the evidences. The first evidence is what you have, inshallah, is it on the screen now? The ayah of the Quran. The ayah that I'm sure, inshallah, all of you, or most of you, you know it off by heart. Part of Surah Al-Qadr. I read the surah, and when we get to that part, inshallah, we repeat it together. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. وما أدراك ما ليلة القدر ليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر now تنزل الملائكة والروح فيها بإذن ربهم من كل أمر سلام هي حتى مطلع الفجر صدق الله العلي العظيم. This is Surah Al-Qadr that inshallah you all know it off by heart. The part that we want to discuss it and just touch on that, the first word that you see on the screen, tanazzalo, a common mistake. Some people, they think that this is madi, this is a past tense. It's a verb and it's a present tense. It has been tatanazzalo, the first ta is deleted, so it is mudare, yani angels and ruh descend. Come down, not that they descended. You know about Laylatul Qadr in the month of Ramadan. Laylatul Qadr, it's not that existed only at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's not that we are every year in the month of Ramadan, we are celebrating the occasion of Laylatul Qadr. Like for example, the mab'ath of the Prophet, when the Prophet was appointed as a Prophet, happened in one night only. Throughout the years, we are celebrating that occasion. Ashura happened in the year 61 on the 10th of Muharram. Throughout the years, we are commemorating it. Whereas Laylatul Qadr is happening every year. Every year in the month of Ramadan, we have a Laylatul Qadr. Proving that is that Quran says that on the night of Qadr, تنزلو, you say تتنزلو, تنزلو الملائكة والروح. Angels and ruh, that the riwayat says ruh is higher than angel, apparently ruh al-qudus. They come down every year, tanazzalu al-malaikatu wal-ruh, fiha, in the night of Qadr, bi-idhn rabbihim, with the permission of their Lord, their creator, min kull am, on every affair, with the command of God, on every affair. When the angels come down, who do they come down to? Do they come down to me? Unfortunately, some people, they claim that on the night of Qadr we see the angels. This is nonsense. Trust me. According to the teachings of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam, the imams, they say that this ayah is a living miracle for the authenticity of Ahlul Bayt, alayhi salam. None other ma'asumeen, alayhi salam, can see the descendants of the angels. And they say that you can challenge our enemies with this surah. You tell them, Quran clearly states that every year on the night of Qadr, angels come down to earth. Who do they go to give the you know, the instruction? تنزل الملائكة فيها وروح فيها بإذن ربي من كلام. It means that every year, angels come down and give the divine instruction. To who? To the divine leader of the world, to the imam. That this is the instruction. It's just like example, just like a king giving the instruction to the prime minister. This is the budget you have for this year. This is the instruction for this year. This is what we want to achieve for this year. Every year, angels come down to earth and give the instruction to the Imam Zaman. Now, is it possible to say that Imam Mahdi is living in a cave in an island somewhere suspended, keeping himself busy with praying and fasting, and then instruction comes to him? He doesn't need an instruction. He can say that my office is closed. I'm not a minister, I'm not a king, I'm not an imam, I'm not an active imam. Why do I need instruction? The fact that Quran says every year instruction is coming down to earth for every matter, for every affair, is given to the Imam, it's a proof, and we have ahadith for what I'm saying to support it. And if you see the ahadith under this surah, you will appreciate it more. That the Imams, they said, of course, at the time of Imam Sadiq, the instruction was coming to Imam Sadiq, Imam Kazim, and any of the Imams. 25 years, Imam Ali alayhi salam was not an Imam, apparently an active Khalifa. But does it mean that he didn't care about the affairs of the community? Of course not. Even the second Khalifa, it's Shia and Sunni narrations, how many times he used to come when he was dumbfounded, didn't know how to solve a matter, used to go to Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam was giving him instruction, helping him. This is Lola Aliyun Lahalaka Umar. So it's not that if people cannot see me, therefore I don't have any obligation and I'm not doing anything. If I don't see, excuse me to say, to give you this example. Once somebody came to me and said that, Sheikh, don't you get bored during the day? Yani you sheikhs, you don't get bored. What are you doing during the day? And I said that, yes, just because you don't see what I do, you think that I get bored. It's the same as because I don't see, we have on family issues as well. Your husband comes home and says, don't you get bored during the day? What are you doing? How much are you changing the channels? And just because he doesn't see what you do at home, and ladies usually complain that it doesn't look really what I've done, my husband thinks that I'm bludging at home, I'm not doing anything. Astaghfirullah, just because we don't see what Imam Mahdi is doing, it is not appropriate to say that Imam Mahdi is not doing anything. If knowingly we say this, rather blasphemy. Look at the titles that is mentioned in the riwayat, and really so many evidence are now bombarding my mind, and I'm just trying to limit it to the limited time that I have. I'm sure many of you that you have studied about Imam Mahdi, you have heard that a simile Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is giving, an example Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is giving, that he says that the similarity of benefiting from Imam Mahdi during his occultation is kal intifa' bi shams. When there is in a cloudy day, how you benefit from sun in a cloudy day. So when in a cloudy day, it's not that the sun is not functional, the sun in the sky, S-U-N. You just don't see the sun. Otherwise, AVA, AVU, all different rays of the sun are coming down and you benefit from it. Vegetations, vegetables, humans, all benefit from it. It's just that you don't see the sun. The message behind it is important. That the Imam is teaching us that don't think that the Imam is not functional. He's not active. In as much as the sun is active, it's just not visible to your eyes. Another example. In the riwayat, Imam Mahdi Ajallah Farajul Sharif, his occultation is given similar to the story of that you saw the movie, Prophet Yusuf. Okay? Question, why Imam Sadiq alayhi salam doesn't say that the similarity, there is absolutely no such hadith. It's absolutely fabricated what I'm telling you. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, none of the Imams have ever said that the similarity between Imam Mahdi is similar to people of the cave, Ashab al-Kahf. There's absolutely no such hadith. Because Ashab al-Kahf were even asleep. They were not doing anything. They were in a cave and asleep. Imam Mahdi, astaghfirullah, is not like this. Imam Sadiq says the similarity of Imam Mahdi is similar to Prophet Yusuf. What was the story of Prophet Yusuf? Prophet Yusuf was the... Let's start. When he was in jail, he was in jail, in as much as Imam Kazim was in jail, but they were doing their imamah. What was he doing during his the time that he was in prison? You know the story. Now that inshallah you watch the movie, he was training his future administration. You remember that all those prisoners later on became the administrators of Prophet Yusuf. Likewise, during his long occultation, our dear Imam is training, educating, and disciplining and selecting his elite members throughout the centuries. Think of a company that in your company you want to choose 5 best programmers in the world. If you have access to the programmers only in Copenhagen, you would have better choice. or if you have access to programmers in Europe, or you have access to all programmers in the world, or you have access to programmers throughout the centuries. Imam Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif, throughout the centuries is choosing, training 313. Maybe one century, only one come out of so many good. That's again something that the Imam during his occultation is doing. After the prison, look at the story of Prophet Yusuf. There is a reason, there is a wisdom Imam Sa'adah gives that similarity. Prophet Yusuf is similar, the Imam says that like his brothers, they saw him, they did not recognize him. Likewise, he is our brother in Islam. Allahu Akbar. Imam Mahdi, Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif, he is our brother in Islam at the end of the day. Innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa. We may see him sometimes in our lives without recognizing him. Yaraunahu wa la ya'rifunahu. Imam Sadiq says that they may see him, but they don't recognize him. What a shame if I see him and he sees me while I'm sinning. Okay? What a shame he comes to my door, is asking something, and I just turn him off. Astaghfirullah. What a shame if a stranger comes and I disrespect him, not knowing that I've disrespected my Imam. Another title, another example, when you look at the titles of Imam Zaman, Ajjalla Farajahu Sharif, Sallu Ala Muhammad Wa Ala Muhammad. Imam Ridha, there is a ziyara from Imam Ridha alayhi salam for Imam Mahdi. In that, Imam Ridha refers to Imam Zaman as Al-Jahjah Al-Mujahid. I repeat, Al-Jahjah Al-Mujahid. Jahjah means As-Sayyid Al-Karim in Arabic language, very honorable master. Mujahid, I think you all know that, warrior. Is it possible someone who is living like a hermit in a cave in isolation, just dedicating himself to worshipping of the God, would Imam Ridha refer to him as Mujahid? Mujahid means someone who is really fighting the enemies. More than that, in a letter that we have numbers of correspondence between Imam Zaman Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif and eminent scholars, Rahmatullah Alayhi Shaykh Al-Tabrisi, in Al-Ihtijaj, he has mentioned some of them in correspondence with the Shaykh Al-Mufid. I may mention one of them, at least a few of them tonight. Imam Zaman, in a letter to Shaykh Al-Mufid, he says, Min Abdullah, similar to his grandfather Amir al-Mu'mineen, they refer to themselves as Abdullah, the slave of God. Min Abdullah al-Murabit fi sabilih. The last ayah, Surah Al-Imran. Murabit means the frontier. A soldier who is in the front line. Brothers, sisters, our Imam is not sitting even back in Copenhagen. Our Imam is the front line. If you see, still the Shia is surviving, has been surviving through all thick and thin that they have gone throughout the history. And now you're observing one issue of ISIS, I don't know, or this Daesh and things like that, because Imam Zaman is in the front line. He's so actively helping his followers. Al-Murabit fi sabilih. The Imam refers to himself as the frontier for the sake of God, the frontier of Islam. Another title of the Imam Zaman that all of you know is, we refer to the Imam as Al-Qa'im. All the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam were Qa'imun. Qa'im means the one who is standing. This is a figure of a speech, not that physically Imam is standing, not sitting. Of course, sometimes like you, Imam stands, sometimes he sits. But Al-Qa'im means that the Imam is in his office. The office of Imama is open. It's not that he's retired or his office is suspended. This is again the meaning of Al-Qa'im for the Imam. As-Sahib. We say Sahib al-Zaman. Why do we call Imam al-Zaman Sahib? Sahib means companion. Sahib is someone who is living with, like, Imam is your Sahib because he's your companion. He's your associate. He lives with you. It's just that you don't see him. Now, if you say Salawat, I provide more practical evidence, inshallah, to you. Evidence related to the practical life of Imam Zaman Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif to appreciate how much our Imam throughout the years, throughout the world, how active he is. That Imam Amirul Mumini alayhi salam, referring to Imam Mahdi, he says, فَوَرَبَّ عَلِيٍّ, by the Lord of Ali, إِنَّ صَاحِبَهَا عَلَيْهَا قَائِمَا جَوَّالَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ فِي شَرْقِ الْأَرْضِ وَغَرْبِهَا يَسْمَعُ الْكَلَامِ وَيَرُدُّ عَلَى الْجَمَاعَةِ. Imam alayhi salam says that by the Lord of Ali, the one who is the owner of this matter of occultation, meaning Imam Zaman, Jawalaton, he's a mobile Imam even. He's not living in one place only. He's a mobile Imam. Jawalaton fi sharq al-ard wa gharbaha. One day Imam is in the Far East, one day he's in the West, one day he's in Europe, another day he's South Hemisphere. He's going around helping the community. Imam Mahdi doesn't need ticket, visa, airplane, booking, and all these things. Rahmatullah alayhi. Once I asked Ayatollah Bahjat that what is this Tayyul Ard? Tayyul Ard is an expression that certain awliyaullah, they can just walk from one part of the world. Let's say they step with two steps from Europe, from Denmark, they get to Karbala, for example. In less than a second. And Quran proves that, but confirms that, by the way. He said, Tayyul Ard is easy. Ask me what Tayyul Sama. Tayyul Ard is easy. Ask me what Tayyul. Tayyul Sama means that two steps and you are in a different world, not on earth. Yani, if this is what Ayatollah Bahjat is talking about, imagine we're talking about Imam Zaman. In a blink of an eye, Imam Mahdi is wherever he is needed. Shaykh al-Mufid rahmatullah alayhi was a very eminent and sincere mujtahid and marja of his time, almost 1,000 years ago. Okay? He was the imam, he was the marja of the so sorry. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And please come a little bit forward. Ahsantum, jazakumullah khairan. Yeah, ahsan. Barakallahu feekum. Yes, please. So sorry. Just put it there. Sorry, sisters as well. Is it possible to come a bit forward? There are some sitting outside. Jazakumullah khair wa ahsan. A man came to Sheikh al-Mufid, rahmatullah alayhi, a'lallahu maqamah, and says, Sheikhuna, Mawlana, my wife is pregnant and she's dying. She's pregnant and she's dying. This is about 1,000 years ago. Aftuna ma'jurin, give us your opinion. If she dies, can we just cut her abdomen or stomach or something, get the baby out? Or we cannot do that, we should just bury her with the baby. Sheikh al-Mufid thinks that cutting the body of a mayyid is an example of mutilation and muthle, and it's not permissible. And he says that, well, he is not born yet. If something happens to your wife, the mother and the baby together must be buried. That's the fatwa mujtahid. The man goes out. As he is stepping out of the house, somebody from behind calls him that, brother, Hajj, whatever, please wait. Sheikh said that, no, just go home immediately, and the moment that your wife dies, cut her stomach, get the baby out. Are you sure? Yes. Go and do this. And this happens. Few months later, the man comes with the baby to Sheikh al-Mufid. Sheikhuna Mawlana, Assalamu Alaikum. Barakallah. Shufi, did you see? This is the baby. Thank you very much. Unless you had sent that guy to give me the second message, we wouldn't have this beautiful boy now. Sheikh says, what are you talking about? Sheikhana, I remember 2 months ago I came to you. First you told me that mother and the baby must be buried. Then you sent someone after me who told me to just get the baby out. Sheikh knows he didn't say that. He said, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. He is in tears and he said that is my master helping me. I don't deserve to give fatwa. Look at the taqwa that they had. I don't deserve to give fatwa. He closed his office. No longer anyone is allowed to seek fatwa from Sheikh al-Mufid. I could really be the cause of the death of an innocent baby. I'm not giving fatwa anymore. The letter that I told you before, من عبدالله المرابط في سبيله, that's the letter Imam Mahdi writes to him. أيها الشيخ المفيد منك الفتوى ومن التسديد. You do your job, we look after you. That was an innocent mistake, technical mistake. Don't worry, we are with you. We look after you. 1890, like about 130 years ago in Iran, this had happened during the time of one of the kings back then. That king was a puppet, went to Europe then, and he signed a contract with one British company that for 50 years or so, he sold the privilege of selling tobacco in Iran. Anyone in Iran sells tobacco, that company has a percentage goes to that company for 50 years. The king is not going to live like that. Because he went and spent lavishly over there, he was in debt, gambling, whatever. He said, all right, you can come to my country and sell and you can get the profit. Mirza Shirazi Sayyid Muhammad Hassan, Rahmatullah Alayhi, was the eminent marja of that time. Shia all over the world were following him, Mirza Abbal. People go to him, Sheikhuna, Sayyidina, see what is happening. And really, this is very unfair. And we are talking about tobacco. You know who is using tobacco? Those who are addicted with cigarette or argili those days. It's not easy to give it up. He says, give me some time. He narrated himself. He said, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I did tawassul to Imam al-Hujjaj, Allah farajahu shariif. We have no power to stand in against the king. We cannot do uprising against the king. But he says that Imam Mahdi dictated to me. He told me, write this fatwa. And this fatwa is recorded in the history. If you're familiar with the fatwa you get from the maraji, you can see that this is not the fatwa of a mujtahid. Because our maraji don't write in this format. I say it exactly in Farsi and I translate it. He said that استعمال توتون و تنباکو به ای نحو کان در حکم محاربه با امام زمان است. The use of tobacco, the selling of tobacco, buying of tobacco in any form, shape or form, it's equal to fighting Imam Mahdi. You never see a marja gives fatwa like this. They either say that is halal or haram or ihtiyat. But if you smoke, it's equal to fighting Imam Zaman. Later on, Mirza says that word's instruction came from the top. It wasn't my instruction. And immediately it was distributed. And subhanAllah, look at the faith of the community back then. Even those who are smoking argili, they stopped. They said, that's a fatwa from Mirza. We are not going to smoke. And the company went bankrupt. And they ended up canceling that contract with that British company. We come a bit forward. One of the very eminent teachers of Sayyid al-Khoi, Ayatullah Khoi Rahmatullah Alayhi, whose name is Mirza Naini. Alright? Sayyid al-Khoi was his student, very eminent scholar. He was living during the time of the First World War, WWW, First World War. And the British army and the Russian army, they were fighting each other in Iran. In between, innocent people in the villages, especially in the northern part of Iran, were getting killed. The news goes to Mirza Naini as the marja, the eminent marja of that time. People complain, Sheikhuna, help us, do something about this. Innocent children, women, men are getting killed. And Mirza is very ghaliq. He says, I was very much uncomfortable, but we don't have the means fighting against them. What are we supposed to do? Again, he says that I decided to do tawassul to Imam Zaman in certain severe situations. That how our leaders they do. He narrates Mirza. He says that I had a dream that I saw the map of, and mind you, that he was not even living in Iran. He was living in Najaf al-Ashraf. He says, I saw in my dream the map of Iran, like a wall that looks like the map of Iran, and it's collapsing, it's falling down. And underneath of it, there were so many women, children. In my dream, I said, wow, Ya Rab, innocent people are getting killed. And I was just trying to hold the wall and I can't. All of the sudden, I saw Imam Mahdi comes and with his finger, he kept the wall and pushed it back. And he said that this is our territory. It may crack, but we don't let it collapse. Don't worry, we look after our community. Let me bring you a little bit closer. And this one, I sort of remember it. Well known, and the evidences for that, the witnesses for that, we know them. They have spoken more than one person. There was a Sayyid, his name is Sayyid al-Kawthari. Some elderly Iranians, they well know him. He used to recite in the majalis in front of Imam Khomeini, rahmatullah alayhi. Sayyid al-Kawthari, he narrates this. He says that it was before the revolution, like during the time of the revolution in Iran, with a delegation, we had gone to Najaf. There was a discussion about what is happening in Iran, and Imam said that Shah has to go. The king of Iran has to leave the country. One of the mashayikh, one of the scholars said, no, it's not easy to get rid of a tenant. Someone has rented your house, you want to get rid of him, it's not that easy to tell him to evacuate. Let alone he's the king. What do you mean he has to go? It's not that easy. Imam is quiet. The Shaykh for the second time raised his voice. He thought that first time Imam didn't hear him. He said, Sayyidina, I say, and he repeated himself. This time Imam Khomeini looked at him a little bit being upset, and he said that, are you telling me that Imam Mahdi is giving me a false information? Shah has to go. And those who have studied the history of the Islamic revolution in Iran, they know that it was a miracle, really, that he left the country. He left the country for good. No one could believe that. We come a bit closer. One day before the victory of Islamic revolution in Iran, In the Iranian calendar is 21st of Bahman. There was a curfew in Iran. I remember that. I was young back then, teenager, but I remember that. There was a curfew in Iran. And that night, the government had announced that no one is allowed to step out of their houses. Otherwise, their blood is not respected. To neutralize that, Imam Khomeini distributed a statement that no one is allowed to stay inside their houses. Everybody come out. I don't know whether I should mention his name, Rahmatullah alayhi. Ayatollah Taleghani used to be the first Imam Jum'ah in Tehran after the revolution. He goes to Imam Khomeini and is pleading to Imam, please change your fatwa. Because the fatwa of the Imam, that nobody is allowed to stay at home, says there will be a massacre. There will be a massacre. There's a curfew. Do you know the tanks are outside? They will be just killing people. This is the blood of the Shia. Sayyidina, please consider your fatwa. And Imam doesn't budge. He says, as much as I pleaded to him, he will not budge. I said, Sayyidina, we lose people. And Imam says that, Aghaya Taleghani, if I tell you that it's an instruction from the top, do you still argue with me? He said, I stopped. I said, if Imam Mahdi wants all of us be killed for him, by all means. No questions asked. I don't have any more argument against you. Subhanallah, look at that miracle. Later on, in the evidence that they found, they said that if that night people had stayed inside the house, there was a plot to attack where Imam Khomeini was living, and they would have killed him and everything would be finished. By Imam Khomeini releasing that fatwa that no one is allowed to stay inside the house, and people trusted him, believed him really. not only nothing happened, no drop of blood shed from anyone, it toppled the regime and the regime of the Shah. And the next day, 22nd of Bahman, became the day of the victory of Islamic Republic in Iran. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Sallu Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
33-day war in Lebanon. And the evidence are there. Witnesses are still there. You continue it. That even the Israeli soldiers, they said, we saw headless people are killing us, attacking us. What are these? Ghosts? And the one who was interviewing them, he was laughing at them. Like, he said, I think that you have lost it or something. No, they had not lost it. Imam Mahdi and his host and his soldiers are always there. Don't ever think, don't accuse your Imam that he is in occultation and isolation. Yes, he is in occultation, but not isolation. He himself, he says that إِنَّا غَيْرُ مُهْمِلِينَ لِمُرَاعَاتِكُمْ وَلَا نَاسِينَ لِأَمْرِكُمْ. Don't ever think that we have forsaken you. Don't ever think that we don't care about you. Otherwise, you would have been perished. Yes, you go through hardship. At the time of Imam Sadiq, the community went through hardship as well. But when it gets to the crunch, we are there for you. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Sallallahu alayki ya Aba wa Abdullah. صلى الله عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك يا عبد الله ابن الحسين لعن الله قاتلك حرملة ابن كاهل الأسدي. Tonight I want to introduce to you, and I want you and all of us inshallah to ask Allah's forgiveness in honor and respect of the most innocent soldier of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and the youngest soldier of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. How can we call him a soldier? The role model for humanity. An infant, when they say 6 months old, we don't know really six more or less, but he was an infant. And when we read the Majlis for Ali al-Asghar, his famous name is Ali al-Asghar. In some narrations, he's referred to as Abdullah al-Radi', Abdullah, that still he was an infant. Mothers especially relate to him a lot. Because mothers that they had children, young children, they know what we are talking about. And still we don't. Imagine, sisters, one night your son or your daughter has a stomachache and keeps crying and you don't know what to do. Do you see how desperate you get? You want to do everything and anything you can do. Take him to the hospital, doctors, medication. And the baby cannot explain, cannot talk. All what he is doing is crying. Now think of a worse situation. Even us as adults, you are doing the gardening and a thorn goes to your finger, you want to pull it out. See how tough it is, how difficult it is. Tonight I want to tell you the story of a baby that an arrow sat on his tiny neck. And you will hear from me, inshallah, that Imam Hussein, his father, is pulling out the arrow. On the day of Ashura, Rubab, the mother of Ali al-Asghar, obviously she's been thirsty because there was no water. And as such, she has no more milk to breastfeed her baby. We are talking about towards the end of the tragedy of Karbala. It's in the afternoon. Ibn Abul Fadl is martyred. Imam Hussein alayhi salam is fighting, and at the same time he hears the cry and the wailing of the ladies and the children. Until he heard that his wife and his sister, Rubab and Sayyid Zainab. They are calling Imam Hussein. He rides back to the tent. And Rubab is standing in front of the tent. And she's giving the showing the baby. Ya Hussein, Ya Abu Abdullah. Look at my baby. Do you see how pale his face is? Do you see how dry his lips are? Wallah, I have no more milk or water to give him. Imam Rida alayhi salam says, on the day of Ashura, some children died of thirst. Rubab says that to her husband, take the baby, I'm desperate, see what you can do for him. And the baby has no energy anymore even to cry. Sort of fainted. Imam Hussein alayhi salam grabbed and hugged his baby, and all what he could do is to run back to the front line. He's raising the baby and shows him to the enemy. And he says, look at his pale face. Look at his dried lips. If you are fighting me, what is wrong with this baby? If you don't trust me, if you think that's a trick, come and take my baby. Quench his thirst, satisfy him, give him the water. There was a dispute among the enemies. Some they say, Hussein is right, it's a baby. We are fighting their men, we don't need to kill the baby. Some they were so cruel and they said no mercy to any of them. Omar Sa'd al-Layli la'natullah alay, a'zama Allah ajura. When we read the majlis for Ali al-Asghar, the heart of Imam Zaman breaks so much. Omar ibn Sa'd al-Layli, he looks at one of his best archers. His name is Harmalat ibn Kahil al-Asadi. And says, Harmala, why don't you end the dispute? Meaning that, Harmala, don't you see the neck of the baby of Hussein? An arrow with three-sided heads immediately lodged in the neck of the baby of Hussein. Imagine the scene of Hussein holding the baby. And all of a sudden an arrow pierced through the leg of this baby. The heat of the blade, I told you that the baby was almost asleep or fainted. But the heat of the blade, all of a sudden the baby jumped. فَصَارَ يُرَفْرِفْ كَالطَّيْرِ الْمَضْبُوحِ. The baby began flapping like when you slaughter a chicken. Abu Abdullah al-Hussein grabbed the blood of his baby, throwing it to the heaven and says, هَوَّلَ مَا نَزَلَ بِي أَنَّهُ بَعَيْنِ اللَّهِ أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْغَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ.